Well, Barry Gibb has wrangled some of his famous friends to give the music of the Bee Gees a brand new lease on life. I caught up with him earlier in the week for a chat.
The Bee Gees!
It was those harmonies, those tight pants, and the way they could knock out a hit that made the Bee Gees one of the biggest bands of all time. Throughout the 60s, 70s and 80s, brothers Barry, Morris and Robin Gibb dominated the charts, selling more than 220 million copies across 22 studio albums. Gibb is the last remaining Bee Gee, and as a tribute to his late brothers, he's got together with some brilliant artists and headed back to the studio.
So Barry Gibb, welcome to the project. Now first up I have to ask, are you wanting me to call you Sir or would you prefer Barry?
B-man.
A B-man, okay. Given you're an Aussie through and through, I was wondering if you'd want Bazza, but let's go with Barry.
I've been called that a lot.
This new album sees some of the Bee Gees' best music reimagined with special guest artists, and what a group of artists you've gathered together. Dolly Parton, Sheryl Crow, Olivia Newton-John, Keith Urban, just to name a few. How did you decide who sings what?
Well, I didn't. There was a whole list of songs that I particularly love and songs that I always wanted to hear recorded better than they were in the first place. I didn't choose them. I let them choose. And that's how it worked.
Parton sings with you on that beautiful track, Words. Of course, you worked together before. You wrote Islands in the Stream, that massive hit she had with Kenny Rogers. What was it like working with her again?
Well, just like it was before. I mean, she's a very, very, very kind, affable person. She's always bubbling. And so when she walks into a room, that it's her room. You know, everyone else has to just sort of go, oh, geez.
The Gibbs grew up on the beaches of Brisbane, having come to Australia as 10-pound Poms in the late 50s, and it was Australia that gave them their first TV appearance and their first taste of fame.
In those days, there was really very little in the way of law and order. You know, kids could just do anything they wanted, and the beach was the place to be, and low tide at night was a wonderful place to be with all the boats resting in the mud, and we'd play on all the boats that we shouldn't have been on. And, you know, we just did all the things that kids do that you probably shouldn't do, like shoplifting and just being full of mischief, you know.
In the 70s, the brothers relocated to Miami and caught disco fever. It was there that Barry unleashed his famous falsetto, and their music became the soundtrack to a huge moment in time.
Staying Alive and that film clip. I have to tell you, Barry, I was a teenager in the 70s when that came out. And just on those white pants, I just want to say belatedly, thank you. Did you have to be convinced to wear those?
It's a tough one. I remember how difficult they were to get on, and I remember how difficult they were to get off.
Did that give the falsettos kind of extra oomph?
Why, are you suggesting that the tight pants were responsible for the falsetto?
I think that took you up another half an octave, surely.
I thought your voice got deeper, actually.
Saturday Night Fever threw you into a kind of mega fame that few artists have ever experienced. How would you describe that time?
I've always said that it was like being in the eye of a storm. I still think that's how it was. We didn't know what was going on around us. All we were interested in was making music and doing shows. We could not believe we were having another chance.
Just talking, telling the lies.
I don't think any of us coped with it very well because we never really became more than naive. I don't think we were always astounded by the success and we were always disappointed by the failures. So that's the life of a pop group. That's what happens. And being in a pop group isn't necessarily a natural force. There's always going to be conflict. And Brothers really is not much different. In fact, I think we lasted much longer as a group because we were brothers.
For all the success, fame, and fortune, perhaps Barry's greatest achievement is his 50-year marriage to wife Linda, whom he met backstage on British TV show Top of the Pops.
You just celebrated your 50th wedding anniversary, which is no mean feat in showbiz. How have you managed to make that work, and what's the secret?
Probably by keeping the real show business out of the house. At some point, you're a family, and it's not more than that. You know, there's no pop stardom in the house. You know, it might be a few gold records here and there, but there's no attitude that there's any famous person in the house. It just doesn't work like that. So it's 50 years as of the 1st of September. And
wow.
And we're very happy. And the tight pants don't fit anymore, so, you know.
Does she ever ask you to try and put them back on again?
I have tried.
How'd you go?
Failure. No, failed. But those days are over, love. I just gotta get a
message to you. What do you think your brothers would think of this album?
Oh, I think they'd love it. I think they'd love it. That's the mission. That's the mission. To keep the music alive no matter what. And there are many more songs yet.
So many great songs. And Greenfield's The Gibb Brothers Songbook Volume 1 is out now. And Barry did tell me that there are more volumes to come because the breadth of hit tunes that they have turned out over the years is just
such a reminder. Oh, yeah. So many.
Totally. And just on the white pants, like, I don't want to harp on, but he told me it didn't quite make the final cut. He had a 27-inch waist when he wore those white pants.
Wow.
Yeah. Even he reminisced fondly about the 27-inch waist. That is all we have time for. I'm a Celebrity. Get Me Out of Here is up next. Stay safe, everyone.